Let's talk about fixations. You might, I think if we go on the internet, we look up the word fixations, we probably find words like, oh boy, like I don't know, they're there, but they're not there. Let me go here and let me look it up. Fixations. Fixations. Synonyms. Synyns. Well, anyways, it says obsessions. Yeah, that's a fixation. Interests. Oh, I read that wrong. It's not a, it's obsessive interest in something. Yeah, that makes more sense. Feeling about someone or something obsessively. Yeah. Phobias is a fixation. If you're afraid of something, spiders, you know, arachnophobia, is that what they call it? Anyways, fixations are something that they can be very dangerous because they will lead you away from everything else. That's the problem with them. You know, if you fixate on something, then you're ignoring everything else. And you're focusing all your attention on one thing, one thing, one thing. Everything else is left out of it. You will find fixations. Well, just to be blunt, fixations are demons. Demons are false ideas. And if we fixate on one particular thing, then we're following a false idea because we have to be open. Logic demands you look at all evidence. So if you cease to look at all the evidence except what you're fixating on, then that's a lie. That's a demon who is keeping you away from something. And the way he keeps you away from it is to make you fixate. I give you some examples of fixation within Christendom. Numerology is fixation. And yeah, numerology is becoming very popular in Christendom. I have a friend who I don't know where these things come from, you know what I mean, as far as a false idea. Where does it come from? Who put it there, you know? People watch videos, they watch all kinds of stuff, you know. And they talk to other people, you know, ideas get into our heads and we think that there's value to the idea. We don't test it, you know what I mean? Test the spirits, don't forget, test the spirits to see if it's a spirit that comes from God or a spirit that comes from the devil, to see if it is the devil or if it's God. It works both ways, doesn't it? So anyways, my friend had this idea that numerology had some kind of basis within Christendom and within following God. And so he started to fixate on the number 3 or 33 or 30, 333. Whenever he saw the words the number 3, it's God tell me something. There's that number again. There's that number again. Well, we chatted about it and everything. I told him that no, don't allow that. Don't let that happen. Because it will take you away from logic. It will take you away from looking at everything else. Scripture's pretty, you don't got to be a rocket science to read the scriptures and see what they say. you know, what is actually written in the ink. You know, the grass will all be burned up. Well, that's what's written in the ink, you know, under prophecy of Revelation, you know, the grass will all be burned up. All the green grass will be all be burned up. And we think, oh, well, we know what that means, you know, with grass. It's, I mow it every week, I'm out in my front lawn, you know. Well, a little problem with that, because if we read the Word of God and we believe what it says, God's already explained that grass is His people. I better, well, I'll tell you what, I'll look it up when I'm finalizing the video. Which side? Here? Maybe here? I don't know. It'll be there. It's where you find it. So if God has already told us that grass is His people, I don't know why I would even allow myself to consider the knowledge of good and evil, which teaches me that the grass is what's out on my front lawn. You know what I mean? It's the same thing with everything. Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 5. It says that the Spirit, who is God, you know, was hovering over the waters. And it's the first day of creation, and He separated darkness from light. Okay. But then you get up to the fourth day of creation, and He created the sun, the moon, and the stars. Well, if the sun and the moon and the stars didn't exist until the fourth day of creation, then what did He separate into night and day on the first day of creation? Well, the biggest clue, I mean, come on, everybody should, you talk about clues in Scripture, Revelation, I don't know. There or there, you know, tells us that waters you saw where the prostitute sits are peoples, multitudes, nations, and languages. Does it start to change our opinion of what happened on the first day and what was taking place on the first day of creation? When God, who is Spirit, hovered over the waters, but the waters are people? What the? Didn't it start to change our impression of what the 7 days, the 6 days of creation are talking about? And especially when you consider that on the fourth day, we talked about the sun in my video, the Aten, and on the fourth day, He created the sun, the moon, and the stars. Well, crap. The Bible tells us that the moon is the faithful witness in the night. And that the faithful witness is Jesus, the Christ. And Jesus told us that night is coming, when no man can work. And it'll remain like that until He comes again. Then we get to the stars. The stars you saw in my right hand are... The seven churches? What? Watch the video on Adam and Eve. Oh, crap. Adam and Eve are not two monkeys who sprang out of a tree and walked upright. No, Adam and Eve are logic and emotion. Oh, everything changes. Everything changes. I guarantee you it's a brand new creation when the Spirit of God comes in you and you actually start hearing the voice of God and not the voice of your own imagination. What we imagine in here is not the voice of God. That I guarantee you. It's not the voice of God. People say, oh, the Lord told me. You're full of shit. Especially when you start flapping this thing and saying that what you think God told you, and it disagrees completely with everything that Scripture's explained to us. And I'm supposed to believe that you hear the voice of God? Oh, my goodness. I don't think so, Tim. Or Timette. Yeah, I'm talking to women here, too. What prompted this video? Someone left a Google Plus on one of my comments. And the comment was with someone who's a little more understanding than most. And I thought, well, is this person, you know, does she understand as much as her Google Plus seems to make out that she understands? So I investigated. I went to her channel and I watched introductory video on, and it started to play. So I sat there and watched it, and I thought, wow. I mean, I'm not criticizing it, but it is not the voice of God that this young woman is listening to. It's her fixation. And it's her imagination. And what's doing it? Well, as long as you're completely fixated on numerology or in observing, you know, secrets of nature, you know. Nothing wrong with that, but it's, you know, the wisdom of the world is not going to lead you to God. You know what I mean? It is, you're not going to hear his voice that way. So anyways, I've left quite a few, want to call them clues, to the unveiling of mysteries in this video. There's quite a few of them. Count them. Let me know how many you find. I won't tell you how many there are. Not right now. But count them up. See what you can find. I think I better shut up. Don't forget. Fix your eyes on Christ Jesus. He is truth operating in the spirit of love. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't fix our eyes on that, but if we do fix our eyes on Christ Jesus, then we're looking at everything. We're not blinded to one specific ideology or anything like that. And be aware that when to be very blunt, when demons invade our minds, change our hearts, to drag us away from serving Christ, from following Christ, just isn't the right path. If you're aware of it, then you can guard against it. It's that simple. I'm not saying it to be an asshole. I'm not criticizing anybody. I'm just trying to make the point that obsession, it'll drag you away. Drag you into sin. Not a good path. Not the right path. Jesus is Lord. Love one another. Bye for now.